Welcome to What to Watch with me, Toby Earle, the show which is excited that Theresa May has decided to break the Brexit deadlock by playing EU leaders in a game of winner-takes-all pool. Until the Prime Minister manages to chalk up a victory, we'll speak to the most dead-eyed stars off the sportiest screen in the corner of the room, or in your queues. Coming up on the show today, the teenage kicks of the Derry girls have returned for a second series, and Nicola Coughlan, Dylan Llewellyn, Saoirse Monica Jackson and Louisa Harland discuss the series' success. I'm on the ropes with Stephen Merchant, Florence Pugh and WWE superstar Paige to hear about their new film, Fighting With My Family. Al Murray breaks down the rules and consequences of Googling in his new game show, Al Murray's Great British Pub Quiz. Rufus Jones discusses the unexpected souvenir he picks up in his new comedy, Home, a refugee named Sammy. And I'll give you my top TV picks of the week, the shows which, if you miss, will make you lonelier than the rat, fat-shamed for becoming stuck in a manhole cover. There's always something you bring back from holiday which you never expected to. A new recipe for guacamole, a newfound hatred for your day job, or, in Peter's case in new comedy Home, a refugee named Sammy hiding in the boot of his car. Home starts on Channel 4 this Tuesday at 9:45 and is written by, and stars, Rufus Jones as Peter, who, unlike his partner and her son, is aghast to meet Sammy. Rufus Jones discusses the unexpected passenger he picks up in his new comedy Home, a refugee named Sammy.
I think Peter's sort of afflicted by that sort of that the toxic masculinity of what men should be 50 years ago, yeah. You know, sort of against what the realities and infinite sort of combinations there are now of what a man can be sort of in a relationship. And I think sort of Peter is falling hopelessly between two poles there. He's only been on the scene about sort of 9 months, and it's Rebecca Staten who plays my girlfriend. It's her house and her son's house, and I'm trying to be some sort of stepfather to this son, and it's just, you know, dreadful. And the more Peter tries, the more it fails. And he then watches in abject horror as this refugee comes in and effortlessly becomes a family member sort of quicker than he has. Yes, he probably doesn't represent the best aspects of white middle class Britain. But yeah, in the show we're sort of also... The one thing we decided early on was that just as with a refugee, you don't want your refugee hero, Sammy, to represent all refugees, because that's just unhelpful. And equally with Peter, sort of, although we were having fun with that disenfranchised white Englishman, we had to give it more of a backstory, more of a, hopefully a slightly more emotional kind of pull with him trying to appeal to his son, his stepson, and trying to make his marriage work. So that there are real problems in his life, and that he's not just, he's not just Archie Bunker, he's not just Alf Garnett. And,
yeah.
You know, the stuff he comes out with tends to be just projected sound bites he might have sort of heard over the last few years, but which are really just, you know, really just flack for his real feelings. We certainly catch him in this series as a sort of unhappy guy. And all that unhappiness tends to be kind of driven from his personal situation, a relationship that's not working. And Sammy's a sort of convenient punch bag,
yeah.
You know, to soak up a lot of that sort of unhappiness. Research was sort of, yeah, it's kind of almost like doing your scales musically before you sort of get in. Because, you know, we are a comedy, and it is fictional. So you want to have the baseline of truth kind of underpinning it, but it's not a documentary. And, you know, so there has to be a sort of creative layer that you kind of put on top of these facts that you've sort of marshalled. You know. I spoke to, there were two refugees particularly who I based a lot of the writing on, a lot of the research on. One of whom, Hassan Akkad, won a BAFTA a few years ago for a thing called Exodus.
Yeah.
There was an extraordinary documentary where he filmed himself crossing, making the refugee crossing from Syria to Greece to to England, and I managed to get hold of Hassan, and he came on board and was a permanent fixture of the entire production. And he was on set with us most days, advising on Arabic dialect and moments where the writer had hopelessly misjudged details of Syrian life.
Invented. Yeah.
Now, what we call WTW, PC, T, Q, O, T, every week, W. What to Watch's pop culture Twitter quote of the week. What a celebrity said on Twitter, this week. Dear at Netflix, regarding your cancellation of The Punisher, you are blowing it. Sincerely, Marshall. Tweeted Slim Shady and Eminem rapper Marshall Bruce Mathers III, disgruntled by the cancellation of the Marvel series. How will he spend his time now his favourite show has ended? Well, he can sing, for the moment. In months and years to come, a question which might pop up in pub quizzes is, which immigrant's catchphrase in adverts was used by Theresa May in Parliament while discussing Brexit? That won't be a question in Al Murray's new series, Al Murray's Great British Pub Quiz. The first round starting at 10 p.m. this Thursday on Quest. Pub quiz teams from across the country compete in Al's pub. And when I stopped by for a fruit-based drink, he explained some of the games, the identity of an awesome quizzer, and his opinion on quiz phone cheaters.
The thing is, when we were putting the programme together, you know, we thought we need this extra element, a barman, and we could talk about the facts. And Sean came up, and he's won Celebrity Mastermind a couple of times, I think, and I think Pointless, and at least a couple of times. He is a serious triv person. It's quite extraordinary. And during the run of the first set of recordings, he, on the last day, he goes, oh, I finally got some sleep last night. And what? And he goes, oh, you know, I've been lying awake at night, running lists in my head, compiling stuff and doing the information. I can't get off in Wikipedia, like putting lists together the whole time. And because he's really into it. Sean is absolutely an extraordinary quiz brain. He is a complete hoover for facts. And we have him in the show, doing this round called Beat the Barman, which is a head-to-head thing with him and one of the contestants from each team, where they have to, you know, like list the countries in Africa, states of the US, FA Cup winners or whatever. It's absolutely incredible. He doesn't know the category, and he gets up there face-to-face. It's amazing. Because we have a thing called What Is It? Where we get, you know, like some object from a museum, and they have to say what it's for. And we've had a thing that's for flipping out your glass eye, and we've had, like a Victorian thing for flipping your glass, levering your glass eye out. And we've had objects that are like, what on earth is this? And that's been a really great round, because those things, there's no answer to it. Although we had a very odd one, which was blinkers for chickens. Right? You put literally chinker blinkers for chickens, because so they don't peck the chicken in front. And the woman on the team was, oh, I know exactly what that is, blinkers for chickens, because after all, chickens are renowned. Everyone knows if a chicken sees blood, the chicken goes mad. So what you've got to have in case that, you know, blah, blah, blah. And she went on and on about it. And you're like, you're right. We've got proper pub quizzes. The teams are people. The call out we did was, we want people, are you a pub quiz team? Are you really into pub quizzing? And so all of the teams are from pubs, and they're people who quiz together. And very often what we've had is the quiz master from the pub, and they brought the two people they think are best from their regulars, who they think are most handy for quizzing with. So we've got some pretty serious people, and then comics of varying helpfulness. Put it that way. You know, use it or lose it is the thing with pubs. You're going to have to go to the pub if you like pubs that much. You often see that when people are saying, oh, what on earth's happening to pubs? Well, you're not going to them, mate. You know, go on a Tuesday. Tuesday afternoon. Get down the pub on a Tuesday afternoon. Well, I really hope people do play along at home, because it is some of it's quite tricky. And you know, we're recording in front of a live audience in the manner of cheers. And if the teams get something right that's difficult, you get that there's a sound of a kind of applause that is an audience going, wow, they got that right. That doesn't sound like any other kind of applause. And there's a lot of that in this programme. if there are people on the, you know, this is supposed to be a safe space, as it were, from telephones, from mobile phones, smartphones. I think it's a crime. I mean, punishable by exile at least. Isn't it the one place where you're supposed to live actually on your wits?
Welcome back to What to Watch with me, Toby Earle, the show that aims to guide you through your week's viewing and give you a glimpse behind the scenes and hear from the stars. Coming up, I'll give you the TV picks of the week, which are almost as good as the new avocado toast trainers, designed to help you run faster, as they'll draw the attention of keen brunchers who'll chase you down the street for a bite of that sweet, sweet arvo. But first, many families avoid a fight, or at least bottle up all their rage for an entire year and then let it explode across the Christmas dinner table. Not so for the gang in Fighting With My Family, Stephen Merchant's new film about the rise of British WWE superstar Paige, starring Florence Pugh as Paige. When I spoke with Merchant, Pugh and Paige, we discussed the challenges of making a sports movie, wrestling with siblings, and the respect now shown to female wrestlers.
I was never a big sports movie fan, and that was not, in a weird way, wasn't what appealed to me about this story. Although it has that on the surface, wrestling is as much about performance and showmanship and entertainment as it is about wrestling. And so to me, I tried to make a film that was about family and about real people who happen to be wrestlers. And I was as much influenced by movies like musicals and movies like 8 Mile, the Eminem rap film. You know, I was kind of thinking about movies like that as much as Rocky.
And I think people tend to think that movie making is all about red carpets and award ceremonies. And the truth is, it's not. That's the kind of icing on the cake. But the real work, you know, it's early starts, it's late finishes, it's, you know, being away from home, it's stress and anxiety. I heard someone describe movie making once as being a director is like being chased down a hill by a boulder, and you're just trying not to get crushed by it. And that is my experience of it, you know. I just like the idea of sort of demythologizing this thing, because I think, you know, people often think that every possible decision in a movie is exactly the decision you'd have made if you had endless time and endless money, but of course you don't. And so, so many of the decisions you make are just based on, you know, oh my God, we're losing the light, we better get moving. You know, people say, you know, every director starts in the morning, they're making Citizen Kane, and by the end of the day, they're making Home and Away.
Me and my brother have been wrestling since we were tiny. There wasn't like a childhood memory where he wasn't like putting my face in the dirt and I wasn't kicking him. So actually that was something, when I watched the documentary, that I totally kind of fell in love with that family and the brother-sister relationship, because I just recognised it as my own in a sense. And the wrestling part of it, I was just dead excited to get in the ring with Jack. In terms of the wrestling world and understanding that kind of whole genre and that fiction and their stories, that was a thing that I was mostly kind of intimidated by, because I did not grow up on wrestling at all, and I don't know how that world works. So we kind of had like wrestling 101, and had to learn the whole world within the space of like a month and a bit. So it was totally mental. They have such better names, and I have a really crap one, which is the Pewster. And I haven't really thought of what would go with that, other than I'd come into the Lion King. And I don't know why. It would just be like, a wee, 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 oh, one boy. And then I kick someone in the face, and I have no idea how that has anything to do with the Pewster, but I have such a weird surname that I have to use it.
But don't worry about being the next me. Be the first you.
I remember calling my family all the time, and Dad would be like, you can't call me anymore if you're gonna cry. And I'm like, all right. So I would call Roy and Zach instead, because they were the only ones that would
He's
be like.
He's got no sympathy, is he? No.
So what are you talking about? Yeah. You're in WWE, what are you crying about? And you're like, well, I'm 18 years old, and I'm in a different country, and the culture's like so different, and I'm going in, thrown into this world where you don't have someone like your brothers.
She's bright, very bright, yeah. 18 years old. Yeah.
Yeah, and I was used to being around Zach and Roy, especially like.
We're like, we're getting anybody such a.
Yeah. I'm used to just being around them all the time, yeah. So it was like like very, it was lonely at first. So when you watch back and you're like, oh, it's kind of bittersweet because you watch the movie and you're like, damn, I was like chasing this dream and now I can't do this dream anymore. But now I get to sit back and really enjoy what I've done in the WWE, you know? Yeah, no, it's just everyone's looking at the female wrestlers in a serious way. And that goes with the fans too. Like WWE gave them an opportunity, gave them a chance, and the fans finally gave them the opportunity, gave them the chance. And now it's like this big, massive thing. And like the girls are just stealing the show now. The main event of everything. Becky Lynch is the biggest thing in Raw and SmackDown right now. So go women.
Yeah.
And now for the TV news in briefs. In you'd think they'd be happy news, cop comedy Brooklyn Nine-Nine has been renewed for its seventh series, and a phone captured the moment the cast were told. You would expect them to be happier. And that was the TV news in briefs. Now, stop wondering whether if you apply the 2,000-year-old face cream found in London, it'll take 2,000 years off your face, because it's time for my TV Picks of the Week. Comedy smash Derry Girls has been universally lauded, especially for the way it doesn't dodge a sensitive issue, 90s fashion. It returns tomorrow at 9:15, and when I spoke with the cast, they shared why this series is braver, how they've been stunned by its global success, and yes, the clobber.
I genuinely do think this is not a difficult second album fair in this case.
It's bigger and it's braver, and I think because last series we've established all the characters now, we're just straight onto the storyline, straight onto the plot, straight onto the antics, and there's a sense of bravery, and it's madder.
And familiarity.
Yeah.
And I think everybody really goes for it.
Yeah.
And it's this time around, and yeah, I think the love is kind of just like oozing off the screen as well.
Even the opening scene of an Aaron in the bath reciting this really political speech, just even the fact that she's in the bath and coming in through that crane shot, it just feels like, okay, we're here, we've landed straight downstairs, and it's just, this
and
is it, we know
exactly. And then I come in a baby
exactly.
Girl eating a Pop-Tart.
Orla comes in and baby girl eating a popcorn, it's like, we know these characters, here we are, and then we're outside in this adventure with Protestants, and starting off what us with Protestants is like, that. Then well, that's it, that's the whole show, and start with a bang.
So and there's so many gags within that topic, and Lisa gets it, the tone right,
yeah.
the perfect balance. And
is it kind of mind-blowing to be making a show set in the 90s before the Good Friday Agreement, while the
and
very
comedy.
And a comedy and but at the same time, while filming a Troubles set piece, while at the same time the very sanctity of the Good Friday Agreement is under threat and is jeopardizing the present and the future?
Yeah.
It's bizarre
and ironic, but I think that's what this show does so well, and that might be an element in its success as well. And the timing of that is obviously completely accidental. But I do think, being from the North myself, and even you feel the same, being from the South, it's a great reminder that we never want to go back to that place, and no one wants to revisit that. And who would have thought that a comedy and Lisa McGee's writing would be the greatest way to remind us of that?
Totally.
Yeah, it's just crazy, isn't it? And it was, especially it being on Netflix as well.
Yeah, that's
like
absolutely
worldwide.
Insane.
Like the most randomest places watching it, like Singapore, Cuba, and Brazil, and the Americans love it as well.
And it's funny because the show is so Irish and it's so Derry that when we were making it, we were like, because obviously Dylan's English, but I was like, I wonder, will your family get it even? I didn't know that the humour would travel, but it's insane how much it has. Louise and I went to New York together and we were getting recognised all over the place there. Like everywhere we went, in bars we were getting shots sent over, and we were like, this is mad. Yeah, the funniest thing though is when the characters think they look amazing, when they look so cool, is when they actually look their worst, and that's something so funny about of the time that they're like strutting along, and it's just, my sister said like, you've got some horrific thing. It's just so unflattering. You wouldn't know I had a waist, you know. It's just all just sort of big shirts, big t-shirts, ski pants. Yeah. The ski pants are back. Like, why? I love Kathy Pryor, our costume designer, but I don't know why she does it to me. I saw them in my trailer on day one and went, oh no, please, Claire. And so someone said the other day, like, do you want to take any of your costumes home? I was like, maybe to burn them, but not. Kathy knows. Kathy knows. Yeah, I love her. I love her, but no. Yeah. You've got some good
stuff. I've got a. Did you watch the Katia episode? Mm-hmm. I wear like a big red Chandler Bing kind of shirt. Yeah, that's coming back.
No school is complete without an aspirational English teacher who produces school plays on the price of a roll of gaffer tape. And in romantic comedy The English Teacher on London Live this Saturday at 10 p.m, that teacher is Linda Sinclair, played by Julianne Moore. She passed on her love for theatre to former student Jason, who returns to his hometown with his tail between his legs, tail, T-A-L-E, after he fails to make it as a playwright in New York. Linda then suggests he stage his play at her school, and the pair begin some extracurricular activities of their own.
How's your neck?
Just say what you need to say.
What kind of teacher are you?
The ending sucks.
You said you'd love the ending.
Well, you know, I do make mistakes, as you know.
Linda, I'm having chest pains and a nervous breakdown. Call me!
That's it for this week. Thank you very much for joining me. I'll be back next week at 6:30 p.m. on Monday. Or watch the show streaming on London Live's Twitter at 12:30 p.m. lunchtime on Tuesdays, while you have a spot of lunch. I'll be back next Monday, so keep watching.